weeks of inundation, a storm, a flood of promotion and publicity, the curtain is about to pull, and Super Bowl 20 will play to this enthusiastic audience in New Orleans. Nearly 74,000 fans, SRO, the stage is colorfully set for the NFL's top two companies, the Chicago Bears and the New England Patriots. Hello, everyone. Dick Enwood with Merlin Olsen. As my friend Kurt Gowdy, the Hall of Famer, used to say, how about the game? Are we finally there?
I think the waiting is almost as hard on us as it is on the teams, Dick.
I saw you out in the hall doing calisthenics.
Well, I'm ready now. Send me in, Coach.
Crowd on its feet. Dennis Gentry is deep for the Bears, along with Willie Gault. It's the Gault side of the field at the 7. And he stopped shy of the 20-yard line. Johnny Rembert in for the New England tackle. Jim McMahon brings the Bear offense on the field. Hilgenberg is the center. Thayer and Bortz at guard, and Van Horn and Covert the tackles. Moorhead the tight end with Willie Gault, an Olympic sprinter on one side, and Dennis McKinnon a good position man on the other side. McMahon the quarterback with Payton and Suhey behind him. First down, Chicago at the 18-yard line. Who else? Walter. And Payton with a gain of about 7 before Steve Nelson can drag him down. New England Patriots defense, a three-man front. Lester Williams on the nose with the rookie Veras and the veteran Adams at the ends. Tippett and Nelson, two Pro Bowlers. McGrew and Blackman, and Blackman is as good as any of them, they say. Lepet and Clayborn at the corners. James and Marion at safety. Payton drilled, fumbles the ball. And who has it? The New England Patriots do. And this is the pattern of the underdogs from New England, forcing the turnovers, 16 of them in the first three playoff games. And the underdogs have come up with a big break today. Julius Adams was the man who made the hit, and Larry McGrew, number 50, recovers the ball.
Here's that last play. It's just as the New England coaches and players would like to have written the script. There's the ball on the ground. A big hit inside, and McGrew inside to pick it up. Garen Veras, the man it looked like, pounced on that, banged him and knocked it free.
Tony Eason, play action fake. He's going to go for the quick score, throwing for his tight end. Incomplete. Lynn Dawson, number 87, and he may have been injured on the play.
Dawson has been fighting tendonitis in that left knee, and he had to wait for that ball. It looked like he may have strained that knee trying to pull that pass in.
Lynn Dawson, and obviously a serious injury. The Patriots have only two tight ends, Dawson and Ramsey, and in many cases like to use two tight ends, especially with that 46 defense of the Bears. That really handicaps them.
Will make it difficult for them. You mentioned, though, that Ramsey, a very fine blocker. It may change what Raymond Berry and his offensive crew of coaches are going to be able to do with their flexibility in this ballgame.
Second down and 10 after the turnover and the long delay for the Dawson injury. Eason over the middle to Morgan, through his hands, and he had a touchdown. Mike Singletary, the middle linebacker, may have gotten a piece of the ball in flight.
One of the things that makes Mike Singletary a great linebacker is his quickness in getting back into coverage. Look at the way he goes back to help Leslie Frazier here. Arriving at the last second and reaching in. I don't think he got a piece of that ball, but he bothered the receiver, the normally reliable Stanley Morgan, who was thinking touchdown all the way.
Eason's first two passes have been right on target to Dawson and Morgan, but shows nothing for it out of the shotgun. Here comes the rush. Open is starring, incomplete in the end zone. He had been chased off course by Mike Richardson, number 27. Otis Wilson applied the hit on Tony Eason.
The Bears put a clock on you. There comes Wilson from the backside, and Eason feels the teeth of this Bear rush. He just barely had time to throw it and hang it out there. They're going to have to try and pick the field goal to settle for three, but the first points in this game, very critical. If the Patriots can get the three, gives them the edge.
Franklin 7 for 9 in the playoffs. This one from 36 yards. Eason to hold. It's on its way, and New England has the early lead. 6. Payton's fumble turns into early points for the Patriots. We have 13:41 remaining in the opening period. So the Patriots have done something that neither the Rams nor Giants could accomplish, and that's to score on the Bears. And Tony Franklin's kickoff sails out of bounds in the 5-yard penalty. That'll give us a chance to update you on Lynn Dawson. We understand the injury is to the left knee, and the Patriots tight end is out for the game.
They'll have to re-kick that ball, and the shutout that these Bears had talked about and dreamed about a bit, obviously gone. Walter Payton, I'm sure. And again, I think the waiting, standing there, the eagerness to be involved in this game is hard on every team. And we said that both coaches wanted to lose that toss. I think they wanted to put their defenses out there and get some whacking in while the offense is kind of settled into this game. That was the mistake that Mike Ditka did not want his offense to make. But Payton is saying to himself right now, hey, that's one series. I'm going to have plenty of chances in this ballgame.
Only cost him 3. Could have been worse than that if Morgan had caught that slant over the middle. We saw that statistic. Only 4 times do you give up the lead and still win the Super Bowl of the other 19. This one is sailing toward Willie Gault at the 13. Gault, dangerous in the open field, brought down by Rod McSwain at the 30-yard line, a 19-yard return.
These New England special teams challenging Chicago right off the bat. They kicked that ball right to Gault. No question about it, too, Dick. A lot of the biggest plays in the Super Bowl have come on special teams. In that area, I feel that New England does have an advantage, although 2 of our kickers have had sickness problems this week. Camarillo has had a back problem. That was a muscle problem. And Butler was very sick earlier in the week.
Butler, the place kicker for the Bears. Jim McMahon sets up shop at the 31-yard line, trailing 3-0. His first pass. Incomplete and almost intercepted by Don Blackman. It was intended for the tight end, Emory Moorhead, and Blackman had a hand on it.
Some great linebackers on the field today. Blackman, a co-MVP last week, along with Fred Marion. And you see him saying, I could have had 6 with that one. Here's the play. He's coming to the outside, and the similar play to what we saw earlier. With the ability to run and to root out those receivers, I'll tell you, these linebackers have incredible quickness.
That's Gault slotting left. Going long to Gault. He's there, and it's a big gain for the Bears to the 25-yard line.
The one thing that Rod Rust will preach to his defensive players, we don't want to give up that long shot. He'll tell those defensive backs, don't you bite on the short ones. That's just a pure up. Gault simply outruns Lepet, and Lepet, making the turn, did not see the ball in time, or he could have knocked it away.
They mark it at the 26-yard line. That's a 43-yard gain, and the Bears, trailing 3-0, are already in field goal range. Out of the backfield, and Suhey, the fullback, tough to bring down, is inside the 20. Suhey again. He's got the first down inside the 15-yard line. His granddaddy, Bob Higgins, played in for the Canton Bulldogs against the Chicago Staleys of George Halas back in 21. He's playing with some heritage on his side.
Now watch Suhey here. Again, the defense responds to Payton, who does a good job of blocking. Suhey was so sure he was going to get hit that he has all of his weight forward, and he ends up losing his own balance. But boy, he had his shoulders about 6 inches off the ground there.
Both wide receivers to the right. Gault split with McKinnon now in motion. First down at the 14. Payton. And he is a marked man. Gains maybe a yard or two. Tippett and Nelson, two Patriot linebackers with the stop.
Strength of this defense, and we talked about it in our pregame show, is really in the back seven. They don't get the kind of aggressive play out of their defensive line that the Chicago Bears do, but this man has put together a highly disciplined defense. That's Rod Rust. A totally different philosophy from the Chicago Bears and Buddy Ryan, but this man knows his business. I'll tell you, one of the most studious and respected of defensive coordinators in the NFL.
McMahon under pressure. Intended for Payton, and there's Blackman again. That's two times that this linebacker from Tulsa has had his hands on a possible intercept.
I'm sure he's just shaking his head. Twice we've seen him get in good position. Right here, does a good job of reading that play fake and getting outside. Just enough finger on that ball to knock it away. Had he knocked it forward, there was nobody out there to stop Blackman or one of the other defensive backs or linebackers from going all the way down to the bare end of the field.
Three wide receivers deployed by McMahon out of the shotgun for the first time. Third and long from the 13. McMahon likes to run. He's got his avenue. Whoa, what a hit at the 10-yard line by Ronnie LaPette. Oh, my.
McMahon literally flies into the air after that hit, and some of the Bears offensive linemen up there quickly to try and protect their quarterback. McMahon
thought we were going to leave his derriere behind, so to speak, but that one may awaken that whole business. Kevin Butler will try to tie it. 28-yard field goal attempt. Rookie from Georgia. He kicked in the Sugar Bowl here in this stadium. And he's got it. With 9 minutes and 20 seconds remaining in the first quarter. Two tough defenses. And as befits that kind of statistic, each holding the other to a field goal early. Butler to kick it off. Down the middle. Stephen Starring. 20. 30. Stephen Starring across the 40-yard line before Dennis Gentry can drag him down. 37-yard return by the former quarterback at McNeese State.
Field position so critical. Starring looking right into the lights. Picks this one up, and this has been a Bear weakness all year long. Starring just lines it up, finds some room behind Cedric Jones, 83, and turns on the afterburn.
Three all, Tony Eason. Remember, now he's working with one tight end, Derek Ramsey, lined up on the right side. Collins in motion. Eason overshoots his man, Starring at the 40 of the Bears. Well covered. Jim McMahon, we understand, nothing bruised but his feelings on that cartwheel tackle of LaPette.
Very physical style of defense from both of these teams, although their defensive philosophy radically different. The Bears will pressure with 8 and 9 men. They stack everybody up on the line of scrimmage. They dare you to throw that football outside.
Apparently McMahon came with more than one headband. He saw the POW missing in action. Another play action. That freezes the defense, and then the pass is poor. Stanley Morgan was open at the 46, incomplete.
Poor execution on Eason's part on that play, but William Perry, number 72, the refrigerator, coming from the inside, working on that play on Hog Hanner, number 73. And Perry, one of the men that finally put pressure on Eason. But if you had the clock on Eason, he had a lot of time to throw.
Well, Morgan missing the easier chance down at the goal line. This one off the top of the carpet That was Eason's fault. So it's third down and 10. The Patriots, a running team, have done nothing but pass in this first quarter. And so it is. And Eason will eat it. He was sacked six times in the second game of the year by the Bear defense. He's down for the first time today. Dent and Marshall in Buddy Ryan's defense get the sack.
Watch the two defensive linemen inside driving to this side and coming from here around the other side, a defensive lineman that's going to pop free. Or make that Wilbur Marshall, number 58, a linebacker who gets wide open up the middle. And that's the way they'll do it. They simply overman you. You haven't got enough bodies to block all those bears. Wilbur Marshall, number 58, in on the sack.
Keith Ortego, number 89, is back at the 25-yard line. Rich Camarillo, bad back and all, hits a good one. Ortego at his 20. And McSwain misses the tackle, but does force him down at the 28. It's tied at 3 here early in the game, and the Patriots, a running team. They only threw 12 times against Miami in the championship game. They've thrown it all six times they've had the ball so far in this one.
Raymond Berry said he would not be predictable today. Indeed, he's come out and broken all of the molds and all of the tendencies that he'd established in the playoffs.
It's McMahon off play action, and he's going deep. Gault at the 47-yard line. Gault, who caught a 43-yard toss to set up the Bear field goal.
You've got to respect Gault's speed. And when he's burned you deep, you've got to give him room. You don't even see LePet. He's breaking out of there. You see that as soon as he turned his back, Gault broke back to the sideline. And McMahon, with a good arm, is able to get him that ball. McMahon strong enough to throw that pass, pick up the big game.
Total yards all in the Bears' favor. The score is even at 3. First down at the 47. 18 yards on that toss to Gault. Tight end in motion. McMahon throws it away.
One of the things that frightens you about McMahon defensively is his mobility. He'll run in two ways. He'll run to the outside to get a little extra time, as he did in that situation. But he will also explode up the middle, as we saw him do earlier, and as he did against last week for a touchdown against the Rams. I think he does that as well as any quarterback I've watched in a long, long time.
Steve Grogan, who relieved Eason early in the season when the Patriots were 2-3 and led him to 6 straight wins. Then he had his leg broken and some damage to the knee, but could play. He's taken some snaps this week and could play in relief of Eason. Second and 10, Gault in motion. Fake to Payton. There's McMahon on the scramble, but he has to eat it at the 45. And the Patriots have their first sack. Dennis Owens, number 98, in on the play. Owens from North Carolina State.
Nowhere to go on the backside. McMahon thought he might be able to find an opening inside. No such luck. The Patriots playing well on defense, although I'm sure they're concerned about those two big passes that they've given up.
Ball at the 45-yard line, third down, about 12 and a half. Three wide receivers and McMahon in the shotgun. Ken Margerum is in on the right side. He's easy to find. He's wearing those black high-top shoes. Give the Payton. That's a play that the Patriots have used well in the playoffs. Andre Tippett on the back of Payton after a short yardage, and the Bears will have to kick it. And there's one of the stars of this New England team, Tippett from Iowa, going to the Pro Bowl. He was second only to Richard Dent in sacks this year. He had 16 and a half.
Exploding off the outside, he got the first chance at him, and Roland James, 38, came up to pick it off.
Irving Fryer, bad finger and all, cut a tendon. He's wearing that little cast on his right pinky finger. And it doesn't seem to bother him. Watching him warm up, watching him in practice this week, he caught the ball very well. The best in the league returning punts this year. Beautiful kick by Maury Buford, and Fryer will just let that one bounce into the end zone. So the Patriots, on a 52-yard punt by Buford, will start from their 20-yard line. Collins and James behind him. It's Craig James, and nothing there except Bear defense. Mike Singletary, 50, plugging the hole.
Mike Singletary is the signal caller. He's the leader on the field for this defense. He looks to the sideline to take the signals. Watch his arms. He's calling defensive adjustments right up till the snap of the ball, and then explodes quickly into James's legs. Now, I tell you, that's a tough job when you have to call all the adjustments for a defense and almost do that automatically while you're settling in on your own responsibility.
What a hitter he is. Second down and 10. Eason dragged down by Steve McMichael. Fumbles. The Bears have it. They rule it. Yes, it is a fumble. And number 99, Dan Hampton, has it for the Bears. McMichael was the one who made the hit and forced the fumble.
Attacking defense. And they're attacking those Patriots right here. McMichael from the outside, Hampton from the outside, but there's McMichael working right there on 61 Wooten, and the ball already is loose as Eason heads for the ground. And there's the celebration by Dan Hampton.
Credit 95, Richard Dent, too. They had Eason in that sandwich, and they had him going one way, and Dent popped him from the backside. Dent, the NFL's leader in sacks this past year. So the Bears have a great opportunity inside the 15 of New England. Tied at 3, 5 minutes left, first quarter. McMahon throwing back to his tight end, Moorhead. And finally, the Redshirts catch up with Moorhead at the 5-yard line, but it's a good gain.
Dick, I can't believe it. There was a clip on that play, an obvious clip by McKinnon, and nobody saw the clip. They came in from the backside, threw right on his legs, and knocked him down. McKinnon is going to throw right here on Blackman. Look at him, right on the back of the legs. He knocks him down off of his feet. Here's the play. McKinnon, 85, right on the back of the legs. Now, you can't tell me that's not a clip, and nobody threw the flag.
Well, the referee was right there and saw it differently. So the Bears on that transcontinental pass to the tight end have a gain of about 8. It's second and 2 at the 5. Payton. Close to first down yardage near the 3.
That play, one of the many gimmicks that the Chicago Bears will run. One of the Patriot coaches said they have every gimmick known to man.
He is short of the first down. The ball is spotted just inside the 4. Third and less than a yard.
Well, I'm sure the officials will look back at that one. The ruling, I'm sure, that they would like to make was that that block was started on the front of the body or thrown on the hip. But when you end up on the back of the legs, as he did right there, coming from that position, hey, if I'm an official, I got to throw a flag on that one. Dick.
So third and less than a yard as the Patriots stack it up inside. And McMahon sneaks ahead. It appears to be enough for the first down. That's an interesting play because we talked to Ditka earlier in the week, and he said George Halas, who hired him before he died at 88, never interfered except in one case. He said, my first game, we had the ball around the 2-yard line and didn't get it in on 4 tries. The next day on Monday, George Halas sent up a couple of quarterback sneaks. He said, it's a good play. He said, I still have it in my game plan. I've had those 2 plays in ever since. He just used it.
Well, a Papa Bear would have applauded that one as they pick up the first down. Patriot defense with its feet lined up in their own end zone virtually. Chicago would love to punch this in and take that 7-point lead.
Tied at 3 all. Time remaining in the first quarter. They go with a double tight end, Moorhead and Reichman. 378. Walter Payton. Smother Payton for a loss. Terrific penetration. Ronnie Lepet came up from a corner to force Payton inside and into a lot of red shirts.
No one runs in traffic, and no one runs with better strength than Payton. You hear the crowd responding. That's William Perry on the field, but look at that great attack there by Lepet, and then the swarming of the red defense Oh, the Patriots are over there with about 8 bodies, and there's the refrigerator.
The rookie from Clemson, Perry, 308 pounds or so. Five rushes, 2 of them for touchdowns. Also caught a pass for a touchdown. Became a folk hero in football this year. It's Perry's going to throw the ball. No, he decides he'll try to run through people, and he doesn't get very far. So they unplug the cord on the refrigerator, and we've got a little extracurricular activity.
Somebody's trying to get the handle off the refrigerator there.
Perry.
It's still not over with.
Ask him how much he weighed when he was born. He said 13.5 pounds. I was born on December 14th, 15th, and 16th.
Well, his nickname on the team is Biscuit. Dan Hampton said he's a biscuit away from 350. Well, he's a little bit nifty there. Gets out of one tackle, but they weren't taking any chances. They said, we'll go get him with 6 of us.
Officially ruled a sack since Perry apparently had designs on the throw. It's 3rd and goal from the 6. McMahon to Thomas, incomplete. Calvin Thomas, the intended receiver, was open, but Julius Adams, the jewel, 37 years of age, playing in his last game after 15 fine seasons, was the man who pressured McMahon into the errant throw.
Coming off the outside, working on Jimbo Covert, and they still say he's the quickest of those Patriot linemen, even after all those hits and all of those years in the trenches. Very fine play.
So Kevin Butler to try one from apparently 24 yards away to give the Bears the lead. Fuller, Steve Fuller holds. And the Bears lead 6-3, but for the Patriots, the moral victory, they stop Chicago 1st and goal at the 3. Timeout, 1:26 remaining in the first quarter. And Butler kicks it off, starring the middleman for New England, has it at the 5. Stephen Starring, and he's toppled at the 18-yard line. Good coverage by Brian Cabral and Wilbur Marshall.
Bears coverage team saying, not this time, Starring. Tony Eason starting at his own 18-yard line on this play.
75% of the time in the postseason, they've controlled the ball and running the football. Eason throwing only 16, 14, and 12 times in the 3 playoff wins, but busier today. On the ground to Craig James, caught in the backfield. And a fumble, and the Bears have it again. Richard Dent appeared to be the man who. James. Gary Fensick was there as well, and the ball is in the hands of the Bears inside the 15.
Buddy Ryan's attacking defense. I think he's talked to them and said, hey, these Patriots have been stripping the ball away. Let's strip it ourselves. 95 attacks the football. Look at him right here, just stripping it away from James and dropping it down. Fensick there quickly to get his hands on it.
We told you that Dent led the NFL with 17 sacks. He also led the Bears with 7 forced fumbles with plays like this. And he's given the offense another golden opportunity. 6-3, Bears lead and have the pumpkin at the New England 13. Suhey down after a couple, shy of the 10. Refrigerator saying, now the next time I'm going to heave that thing. I want to get the ball in my own end where I can really unload along
the air. Well, the pressure that we talked about from that aggressive Bear defense, and they just come out there and attack you. As we said, the philosophy is so different on these two teams. And Buddy Ryan says, hey, we're not going to give you a chance to move down the field. We want that ball back right now. Well, they did it right there, taking it away on the first play of that drive.
2nd and 8 at the 11. Whoops. Don Blackman was offside. Suhey is in the end zone for a touchdown. The flag is down, but unless Blackman was drawn offside, Chicago has 6 more. Touchdown, Bears.
Penalty is declined. Touchdown.
You'll see number 55, and he just got off too quickly and then stopped, and that's the mistake. You never stop on defense when you go offside, because that's exactly what can happen to you. It's a free play for the offense. That one ended up with a free touchdown.
Butler's try for point. And the magnanimous play of the New England Patriots and the tough defense of the Bears. Back-to-back fumbles by New England, and the Bears pick up 10 quick points and have the lead with just seconds left in the first quarter. And Butler to Starring at the 8. Stephen Starring bumped out of bounds at the 24. Reggie Phillips, 48, made the play for Chicago. Well, Merlin Olsen, you talk about this Bear defense. Unquestionably number one in the National Football League, from the statistics right down to the fans in the stands, and they have shown their strength the last two New England possessions. And look, in the hole, a minus 22, the New England offense.
They've got it in reverse at the moment, and they've got to change and go the other direction.
James gets the call, and he's out to the 27-yard line. Little late hit. William Perry made the stop.
I think the refrigerator's still stoked up over those bangings he got down there when he became a quarterback.
And that's the end of the first quarter, and it's the Bears fans who stand and cheer. Chicago by 10. Perhaps long before he realized his pro dreams, Jim McMahon was destined to be a Bear. In Gaelic, McMahon means son of the Bear. Goes back to 1100 AD to an Irish king, man, the Bear. Eason knocked away. A good play by Mike Richardson at the left corner, intended for Stanley Morgan. Steve McMichael applied pressure. Let's look at the first quarter statistics.
Very one-sided stats. Boy, how many times do you see negative rushing, negative passing, negative total yards? And of course, the possession time, which the Bears have dominated all year long. And Buddy Ryan's point well made. He said part of the reason that we dominate in that area is because we don't let teams keep the football that long.
Here's Buddy Ryan. Interesting interview with him. Kamrad Rashad in the pregame show. He's outspoken. Eason to Greg Hawthorne, and on his back is Dan Hampton. Hampton not fooled a bit, and the giant M from Arkansas registers another loss.
Big Dan Hampton right in the middle of that defensive line. 99. Watch him here around Pete Brock, number 58. And they almost had that play pop to the outside. They were going to hand it off to Hawthorne in motion, but Hampton quick enough in the penetration to break it up.
Rich Camarillo in to punt. Keith Ortego, a rookie from McNeese State, is back at the Bear 33-yard line. Good kick. Ortego at his 30. And returns about 11 yards. The Bears in good field position at their 41 after the 47-yard Camarillo punt. Chicago with the first down after the punt at the 41-yard line. Dalvin Thomas hit hard. Gain of maybe a yard. Thomas from Nelson and McGrew made the tackle.
I think I'd like to correct something I said earlier. I said that the Patriots had only turned the ball over twice. Their offense has only turned it over twice. They've turned it over twice on punts, so they've turned it over four times off of their total. And you see a very serious and reflective Raymond Berry. He does not like the way this game is going so far, but he won't tell you much. He won't tell you much. You look into those eyes when they're winning big, you still got that same look.
Second down and 9. McMahon to Thomas, hit immediately at the 46-yard line. McGrew and Tippett
collaborating on the stop. A 4-yard pickup, bringing up third down and about five. Those four linebackers, you said way back in the middle of the season, Merlin Olsen, you felt that that was the best linebacking core in the NFL.
Well, they certainly have made their mark. They've got some fine backups. They actually have eight good linebackers, and Clayton Wysoon, who 2 years ago was their best linebacker, of course, has been injured. Been out really for a year and almost 2 years. They feel he'll be back and challenging for a position next year.
McMahon out of the shotgun. And it's Gentry on a handoff. Dennis Gentry plowing for a first down at the New England 46. Fred Marion and company with a stop. But on the right side, started slowly in motion and takes the handoff from McMahon.
Another one of those gimmick plays, if you will, an unusual play. And when you have extra time, you can put more of these into your bag of tricks. Ditka's got it all going for him today. Of course, Gentry with that great speed off and out of the backfield as a ball carrier anyway. Very comfortable in that role. Did a good job of picking up the first down.
Payton and Suhey, the starting tandem, are back. And Gault in motion. The throw to Gault. Ooh, good move by Willie Gault at the 39-yard line. A pickup of seven more. Willie Gault, you'll remember him as part of that world record setting sprint relay team in Helsinki at the World Championships back in 83. Ran the second leg, and boy, he made himself a lot of extra money when they saw him pass everyone on the far side.
Well, you've got to believe that his speed will scare you. He has 69 yards today, a couple of big catches. Look at him right there. Oh, just twisting around. Not just a sprinter, he's a football player.
Second and short for McMahon and the Bears. Man looking long to Suhey, and it's another big game for the Bears at the 15-yard line. Clayborn made the tackle, and they are throwing everything at New England.
They're coming right at this New England Patriot defense, but I think it's been burned a couple of times deep, and they've backed off a little bit. McMahon finding lots of room underneath. It looked to me like Clayborn stumbled a little bit as he started back towards Suhey. That made him late enough that he could not cover the ground to knock that one away.
Well, that's often a dangerous pass. Suhey in motion, and that deep swing down the sidelines. The ball hung up there.
It's up there a long time.
Clayborn was playing too far off his man, or at least that area. First down. Suhey. Oh, the big fullback powers through two hits and leaves a wake of red as he goes inside the 10-yard line.
Right now, these Bears able to do whatever they want. Ditka standing next to Ed Hughes, his offensive coordinator, deciding on a place. Let's see what they did to Andre Tippett on that last play. Tippett trying to work to the outside. Ben Thomas, 99, driven way off the ball. Tippett shielded from the play, and there's the shot. Thomas getting a hand around. Way for four more yards.
Second down and three. Suhey again. And he's toppled at about the 7-yard line. That'll be short of the first down.
Dick, when you know that your defense has really established the tempo of the game, and that's what's happened here for the Bears. They have just gives you a free hand offensively. There's the signal going in from Steve Fuller, the backup quarterback. Often the Bears will signal with two people. They're a little paranoid about people stealing their signals. That's kind of a Bear tradition. They used to do that often in the past. Still enjoy doing some of that.
Third and a long yard. Suhey has the first down at the five. Now, apparently the Bears scheme, Merlin Olsen, has been the New England Patriots keying on Walter Payton, so give it to Suhey.
In that 2 weeks that these teams have had to wait, both of them have been able to do a good job of scouting themselves, of profiling their own performance. And I think in the process have said, how can we break
some of those tendencies. I think we're seeing that from the Bears today, and we're seeing plays, obviously, that this New England Patriot defense has not seen in the films.
Well, it's the first thing they have not done well. McMahon upset he could not read the signals coming in from the sideline, and the 30-second clock was already down to 14, so he has spent a timeout. It comes with 8:07 left in the first half. During the timeout, teacher and pupil, and they haven't always seen eye to eye, McMahon and Ditka. Ditka's given him his freedom. One of the writers here described McMahon as a laboratory experiment gone awry. He is a character, but this is a charismatic team, the Bears, and they've captured more than just Chicago with their play and performance this year. First and goal at the 5. Chance to really blow this open. It's Payton. Cut down at the 3. Garen Veras was down low to stop Payton, and here comes the refrigerator. William Perry joins the backfield of Walter Payton. Suhey goes out.
I think my favorite of all of his plays of the year was in that Dallas game when he tried to pick up Payton and carry him into the end zone. Well, big fella, you've made the lineman proud. We know we can carry the ball. We're just glad somebody gave us a chance to do it.
Uh-oh. And McMahon didn't like the setup that he saw defensively or was running out of time, whatever, so he has called his second timeout in this series. No spot to make a mistake. We have a 13-3 lead and chance to jump up 20-3. Well, let's see what the exchange brings us this time.
Ed Hughes goes out to meet him, maybe to see exactly what was wrong.
He is wearing gloves and thereby set some sort of a trivial record. First quarterback to ever play a Super Bowl game indoors with gloves, a carryover from his winter experiences at Soldier Field.
It's interesting. He's talked about the slickness of the balls, and he said, you know, I can't ever get my hands on those balls properly, and I always was losing the passes. Everyone has watched as he's thrown those end-over-end egg beaters. He's not a crisp passer anyway. They said he threw the ball better with the gloves on last week, or 2 weeks ago in that game against the Rams, than he'd thrown it before. And he said, I'm going to keep these suckers on. He said, I can throw the ball better, get a better grip on that ball than I ever could with my bare hands.
He said two things. One, when you use a ball in practice, as they will in college ball, and then in the game, you wear off some of that gloss of a new ball. He said, I also have a small hand. He said, I actually have just as good a touch, and I throw a much better spiral with the gloves on. He said, I might use them again all next season.
Well, he's had good accuracy today. He's thrown some interesting passes. Well, I'll tell you, a defensive nightmare trying to figure out where these Bears are going to go next. They're using every trick in the book, but executing extremely well.
Well, now they've got two tight ends in and an extra guard. The only true running back is Payton. They've got nothing but linemen, including William Perry in the backfield.
319.
Moorhead, one of the tight ends in motion. Perry drives through, and following behind is McMahon for the touchdown.
It almost looked like an option play, and there you see McMahon headbutting with his offensive line. Early in the year, he had done some of that, and then showed up one day with a back problem. Ditka said he thought it was from the headbutts. He said, I don't want you guys doing that anymore. I think McMahon said, hey, this is a Super Bowl. We're going to butt those heads.
Here's Perry driving, faking, and then just driving somebody. Oh, my goodness. Did he destroy Larry McGrew?
I think Larry McGrew thought he'd been run over by a truck.
Butler to try the point after. And the Bears, the solid favorite in this game, beaten only once all season long. The top team in the NFL are showing the Patriots why, as they have jumped out to a 17-point lead.
This was the reaction on that last play as McMahon carried it in for the touchdown.
7:24 remaining in the first half. We talked about the differences in character. Well, McMahon and the Bears have certainly been animated, and Eason very quiet in a lot of ways. But here's Starring trying to change things,
And a saving tackle by number 59, Ron Rivera from the University of California. Well, Bob Greasy, that touchdown looked as if they had a couple of blocks in the point of attack.
Well, you talk about a decoy. Right here is Perry. He's going to come right in here and get McGrew. Now, it's really an option. Payton is going to come this way, and McMahon has the option to pitch it back or turn it up inside. But the block, you say, number 72 Perry on McGrew, and McMahon has the option to pitch it back and sees the hole up and heads in for the touchdown.
Pretty good block by Tim Reitman, the tight end, along with Emory Moorhead. Both tight ends wound up helping out on that hole as well. Craig James, a yard, the refrigerator.
Well, we've mentioned the headbutting that was going on early in the season. Ditka said those guys were trying to split their helmets earlier. They're not trying to hit them that hard here. Almost symbolic headbutting.
Little Super Bowl kiss. 20-3, the Chicago Bears lead it with 6 minutes and 50 seconds remaining in the first half. And the Patriots are still in the minus pool without a first down. Second and 9. Collins. He's dropped, no gain. Wilbur Marshall, in fact, a 2-yard loss as Marshall from Florida, the second-year man, makes the hit.
Well, we gave you one thing to look at early at the top of the show. We said we were going to watch the big bodies on the line of scrimmage, and that would give us a quick pulse. Well, the pulse has given us that kind of yardage. Negative 25 for the Patriots. The Bears, of course, dominating offensively on their line of scrimmage.
Now third and 12, and this is where the Bears are really tough. They bring up those 8 men at or near the line of scrimmage. Eason out of the shotgun, and here they come. Oh, my. Otis Wilson, a Pro Bowl linebacker, was there first.
Well, Bob Greasy said it early. He said he felt that Eason would still have scars from the earlier game when he was confused. You see what Eason is doing? He's jumping around. He didn't even know where to run on that play. Didn't know where to throw. Didn't know where to run. Listen, I don't blame him. I wouldn't want to stand down there.
Boy, that Bear defense has been awesome in this first half. And now Camarillo will kick from around his own 5-yard line. Keith Ortego back at the Bear 40. Short kick this time. Ortego, fair catch at the 48. Oh, wait a minute. That's going to be a penalty. Called for a fair catch, and then they use the reverse as Leslie Frazier, 21, took the handoff from Ortego, but the flag is down. He called for the fair catch and then ran the ball, and the penalty will be marked off from that spot.
Now, the question is, oh, and Leslie Frazier, starting corner, is still on the ground. They're looking at his knee.
Invalid fair catch. Signal on the fair catch. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Invalid fair catch. Signal. And so the 5-yard penalty from that spot. And now Frazier being attended to.
Watch this reverse, and we mentioned the gimmicks, the little tricks that these Bears would like to throw at you. Not a good kick by Camarillo, and it kind of faked him out. There's the signal, and I think what happened is for a second he forgot that they had that reverse on. But he got there and picked up the football. Bears are lucky.
Ooh, yes, he
actually
fumbled.
With that fumble, if New England recovers, they could ignore the penalty.
And would have had the ball. So Frazier hit hard, loses the football. Dave Dorison, number 22, is the man who fell on it for Chicago. Tom Ramsey, the third string quarterback for New England, involved in sending in the signals. Grogan with the ball cap in the background, and boy, that brain trust trying to figure out something.
A lot of people hoping that Grogan would be able to get into this game. Actually, he prefers the kind of passes that are most dangerous for this Chicago defense. The reverse angle on that injury to Frazier, and watch him here as that leg is twisted. Getting him up off the ground now.
Merlin, with the success of this Bears 46 defense, are we going to see a lot of other teams using it? Why is it that they do it so well?
Well, I think a lot of the secret is in Buddy Ryan and the fact that he's had 8 years to work on this defense. He was there waiting for Mike Ditka when he came. And Buddy is like a great orchestra leader. He really gets these players charged up. It's also a high-risk defense. And one of the problems is that when you're doing this many different things, you can beat yourselves. The Bears do not make a lot of mistakes, but the potential is always there.
You've got to be bright to play it, don't you?
You really do.
First down after the penalty, and Payton.
Oh, my.
Typical of Payton through his great career, making something out of nothing. 5 yards.
Change of pace. Absolutely freezes the defensive man on the outside. Julius Adams will get out. He looked like he was offside. He gets outside because of a late start and gets a chance at Payton there. Simply couldn't get his arm around it, but the great move was downfield. Payton just froze one of those linebackers and went right around him.
Meanwhile, Tony Eason said, hey, maybe they've got more than 11, coach. I don't know.
I don't know if Bears bit him in the lineup. I don't know.
We'll do it.
Ooh, fumbles.
And New England has it at the 46-yard line. So the Patriots get a break. As Suhey didn't appear that he was hit, might have been changing the ball. And Steve Nelson was there to make sure that it rocked free.
Raymond Clayborn picked that ball up. There you see Raymond coming off the field, and Eason looked a bit disappointed there in the sideline. He'll get his hands on the football again quickly here. There's the strip on the outside. 55, Blackman sticking that hand in there, and that's something that Barry has his whole team do every day. Practice getting on those punts, getting that ball and laying down successfully. Raymond Clayborn did it there. I'm not so sure that Eason and that offense want to go back out. Oh, Grogan's out there.
Steve Grogan, the veteran from Kansas State, playing on a knee that is hardly 100%. The veteran, and he chases the fly swat. It was wide open. That ball was up for grabs, and no one saw it. Richard Dent, what a force he has become. Reminds me of your former teammate, Deacon Jones, so quick off the ball, always surrounded. And there he uses those long arms to knock one high in the air.
Brian Holloway said something to me. He said he's so fast, but he looks like he's gliding off the ball. Here he is coming off on Holloway, who lets him go. He goes right up in the air. That looks like he's spiking a volleyball when he got up there. An almost identical play in the Ram game 2 weeks ago. In that play, it was McMichael who almost got it and headed in for a touchdown.
Second and 10 for Grogan. Completes it to Collins, and Tony Collins is into Bears territory with the first New England completion. It comes with 4 minutes and 50 seconds left in the first half.
Eason will not be pleased to remind himself of those stats. I said earlier that Grogan matches up better against the Chicago Bear defense than Eason. The reason is Grogan loves to go to the outside receivers, who are usually man-to-man coverage in this Bear defense. Eason likes to throw to the backs and the tight ends. Let's see what Grogan is going to do out of the shotgun here. He's going the long one.
That was an 8-yard gain, the longest of the game for New England. Third and two to James. Good move by James, and a first down, the first of the game for the Patriots. Gary Fensick, 45, with a tackle, and James pulling at that hamstring. Singletary is down.
Isolation of Craig James, and this ball had to be thrown in a hurry. The heat was on. James, that's such a tough catch. A double circle, 2 360s. He still gets himself upfield for the first down.
It was Perry that hit Singletary. That 308 pounds plus of Perry driving into the tackle, and he destroyed his teammate Singletary. They work on that middle linebacker of the Bears, apparently at least okay. Ask Mike Singletary. It's not always fun to be around refrigerator.
You want to know how tough he is, though. He gets up from that hit. A lot of times you're hurt by your own players. In this case, Dent putting the shot on Grogan. I'll tell you, Grogan will take those shots if he can complete the passes. He is tough.
Their first down. Now it's Tony Collins. And the blade, as they call him, because of the way he chops down the defenders with his blocking talent, is dragged down by Fensick and Hampton.
Dick, two things to think about. There, and there comes
there comes one tough son of a gun right there. Singletary coming back in. They want him out on the field. He's their leader. But Grogan, as a second quarterback going onto the field, a lot of times the defense will let down a little bit. Also, remember, he favors the outside receivers, and Mike Richardson is on one side, but Frazier is out of the game. So they got a replacement over there in his place, Phillips.
48, Reggie Phillips. Second and long for Grogan. There he is. Throws the quickie to Derek Ramsey, but well covered. Wilbur Marshall. Hampton in the face of Grogan.
Grogan signaling what he wants in the way of people on the field. And remember, Raymond Berry lets Grogan call his own plays. Grogan did that earlier in the year. Irving Fryer, one of the people out there quickly. And it's interesting to see how quickly now there's a shift. You feel a little shift down there. A little more confidence, perhaps, in this veteran leader in this tough situation.
3 minutes and 10 seconds remaining in the first half. The Bears dominating. Lead 20-3. Grogan for starter Tony Eason has a 3rd and 7. And he had to throw it away as that 46 defense just in on Grogan before he could even search out his intended target, Stanley Morgan. Otis Wilson jamming Grogan to the turf.
They'll put a clock on you, and they're bringing the whole group just driving over the top. And Grogan, who's feeling the heat, Singletary up in there along with the lineman, had to throw it away.
Well, they occupy, as you said before, all the middle of the line occupied, so that leaves someone free. Here he comes.
Oof. Otis Wilson from the outside, one of those two linebackers that lines up over there on the tight end, and they just didn't have enough bodies to get him blocked.
So the fumble recovery. Suhey's fumble leads nowhere, and Camarillo skids one off the side of his foot, and that'll be marked around the 15-yard line. And they're motioning to bring the ball back. They may not have gotten that off in the 30 seconds.
Well, Ditka obviously pleased with the way things are going right now.
Yeah. Now Red Cashin is taking the ball down where it went out of bounds and motions it's the Bears ball at the 15. Bob?
You know, Dick, since Steve Grogan has come in the ball game, the Bears have blitzed. Here are their two linebackers here. They'll both be coming, and also Singletary coming in to put more pressure. Now, the open man is going to be out here on the top of the screen. The problem is Grogan does not have time. He just cannot block Wilson, number 55, has to throw it where he thinks the receiver is going.
They mark it at the 20-yard line, the short kick, and here comes Walter Payton across the 25-yard line. Payton, whose older brother Eddie is the golf coach at Jackson State, and by the way, won the NFL golf tournament here this past weekend. He described Walter as the reincarnation of a great white shark. He says, when Walter stops driving forward, he'll die. He's a man that is just 152 games straight that Payton has played. All that blocking, all the hits he takes, and yet the way he has endured.
So amazing, because he still attacks the defense. I mean, he doesn't run away from anybody.
Everything in favor of the Bears. They have the ball. Time running out. 2:19 left in the first half, and here comes Payton to a first down at the 32. 20-3, Chicago leads, and plenty of time left in this half for them to get more.
See a resting defense for the moment, but boy, when they're on the field, they're all in motion.
Oof. 2 minute warning. The Bears 20, the Patriots 3. Look at the size of that man.
With all of the headbands going around, are we talking about renting space on some of these players? I'd like to rent the refrigerator. I'll divide him up in 8 pieces and just sell those 8s.
Yeah, he'd be a human billboard, all right.
Well, I don't blame you. That's Roddy Manick down there trying to help Grogan with some kind of an idea of what to attack that Bear defense with. I hope that's a good idea.
Well, if you're in favor of a close game, that wouldn't be a bad thought. But it's 20-3 Chicago, and McMahon to Payton out to the 35-yard line. Gain of 3.
I said a little while ago that Payton attacks the defense, doesn't try to run away from you. Of course, he'll dodge and he'll run if he's got open field. But when it's finally settled, when he knows that those defenders are in position to make the tackle, he goes right at them.
McMahon off play action. Plenty of time looking for Reitman, and it's incomplete. A flag is down. Tim Reitman just off his fingertips, former UCLA star. He was the first man to sign with the U.S. Football League, the Chicago Blitz, and now has stayed in Chicago to play for the Bears. A rare penalty flag, and they try to sort it out.
Illegal hands. Number 42 on the defense. Still set
against
down.
New England. Ronnie LaPete.
LaPete working on McKinnon. McKinnon had a hip pointer. They were really concerned about it. Ooh.
No question about that.
I don't know if you want to attack a bear that way.
Well, the penalty marked down to the 40-yard line. And a first down with it. 20-3 Chicago with 1:35 left in this first half. A gloved McMahon throwing it away. Tim Reitman was closest. So a minute and a half left, and for the New England Patriots, that's going to be a real challenge for Barry when he takes him into the locker room.
No question about it. If you talk to these Chicago Bears, they trace the origin of their energy and their strength and their drive this year back to that 23-0 loss to the San Francisco 49ers in the playoffs last year. They said that time they went into the game, they were not ready for that ball game. The 49ers were playing for the Super Bowl, and they were playing not to lose. They vowed it wouldn't happen again. So far, it's working pretty well for them.
Second and 10, batted in the air, incomplete. It was Andre Tippett, outstanding player. And Mike Ditka, 46-year-old head man now, the Bears, coaching in the image of the man he admired so much, his own coach in Chicago, George Halas. Played basketball at the University of Pittsburgh, and he played it, as Adolph Rupp would attest, the late great coach of Kentucky, he played basketball the same way he played football. Same technique.
Same philosophy. I don't think he lasted through many of those games. I've always felt that teams molded themselves into the form of their coach, given some time, and the toughness, the determination of this team reflects the kind of man and the kind of player Ditka was in all of those years.
Third and 10 shotgun. Good protection. And there's your open man, Dennis Gentry, and a first down at the New England 46. Out of bounds to stop the clock with 1:19 left in the half. 14 yards on the play.
Taking a look from the
McMahon trying to hurry his team. He didn't want to go into the huddle. And there's a difference, one quarterback getting time and the other one not.
McMahon had all day back there. Of course, a different philosophy here. The Rod Russ defense will lay back. They'll usually rush their ordinary complement of people, one extra linebacker. They blitz very little, where you'll see seven players coming frequently for the Bears. You rarely see more than five. In fact, in all the playoffs, up until this game, they had not blitzed more than five people.
Gentry staying on his feet and paying for it to the 41 of New England, a five-yard gain. Roland James coming up to help out Garen Veras. 1:04 left in the half. The clock running. Nice 20-3, the Bears. 52 seconds as McMahon complete at the 12-yard line to Ken Margerum. Margerum with a 30-yard gain. Timeout Chicago. Gentry fumbles, picks it up, and goes to the 10-yard line. So a kind bear bounce. Clock will run. 2-yard gain.
They throw this one just to stop that clock.
four wide receivers in. McMahon going to run it. Wide open. He's all the way to the two. Now they'll quickly sit up, try to at least get. Now that'll stop the clock and an unwise play by a New England Patriot.
Well, they, haven't stopped the clock yet. Down to 4 seconds, three.
There'll be a penalty on that as there were players all over the field, but that doesn't matter. The Bears will still get a shot at the field goal. Three seconds show on the clock.
That was a an egg beater of a play down there. Of course, the New England Patriots trying to hold everybody down. They had McMahon on the ground. They're trying to hold him down. They know there's not any time on the clock. The Bears try to get lined up so they can throw that quick pass or get the ball snapped and get the clock stopped. That's
Fred Marion, 31. He won't let McMahon
Marion
go.
Is trying to keep him on the ground here. McMahon is pushing and shoving to get back up, and there gets the return shove, and look out.
Van Horn.
I'll tell you, though, he takes those offensive linemen out to eat once a week and picks up the check. They're not going to let anything happen to him.
Kevin Butler, two short field goals, and this one, the shortest of the lot, will be only 20 yards. Actually, the ball's going to be spotted inside the 10, so a 19-yarder.
We got illegal procedure on the offense. They were not set. 5-yard penalty.
Illegal procedure against the offense. Actually, there are men moving all over. McMahon just wanted to get the play underway to stop the clock. And they haven't marked off the penalty yet.
Well, here it goes. They're going to move it back. Make it a little bit tougher anyway.
All the way out to the 7. So it'll be a 25-yard attempt. Maybe 24, depending if he spots it just in front of that yard stripe. And he nails it. Not kicked artfully, but good direction. Three field goals, and that's the way the Bears cap this domination of the first 30 minutes of Super Bowl 20. McMahon and Chicago's brilliant defense leading the Patriots 23-3. We start the second half. Butler drills it deep to Stephen Starring. A yard into his own end zone, brings it out. Starring to the 20 and to the 22-yard line. And a good hit by Brian Cabral, number 54. 24-yard return, and the Patriots, let's see what they have devised for this second half. Steve Grogan, the veteran of 11 years out of Kansas State, the quarterback.
Well, I don't know if you've got enough Band-Aids to put on the game plan to get you back to where you work after this one. But believe me, one thing you know about Grogan, and one thing you got to know about people like Hog Hanna and Holloway and Brock, they're not quitters. This New England team has fought through some tough times during the year. This is maybe the toughest they've looked at all year.
Yeah, they were the long shots. Going into the playoffs and three upset wins. The quickie is to Morgan, and he's ripped out of bounds at the 30-yard line. Reggie Phillips for the injured Leslie Frazier with a tackle after an 8-yard gain.
There's exactly what you talked about, Bob. The quick pop to the outside, and New England comes up with a pop here.
Jesse Craig James, the leading rusher for the Patriots, and that's it. 3 yards is the long gain. In fact, Morgan's 8-yard reception is the longest of the entire game for New England. You haven't missed much if you're a New England offensive fan. The second first down of the game is Tony Collins up the middle. Wilbur Marshall made the hit. Oh, the Patriots on the quick out of 8 yards, then 3 yards on the run by Collins have the first down out at their 33-yard line. There are the fewest first downs. Minnesota in Super Bowl 9. And also the Dolphins, surprisingly, in Super Bowl 17 against the Redskins, had only 9 first downs. Grogan
tastes the bite of that defensive rush. Steve McMichael, 76, was there first, and 95, Richard Dent, to polish him off. McMichael, who after the football season will go back to his hobby, rattlesnake hunting in Texas.
Dent all the way on the outside here, and what he's going to do is come completely around from the backside using his great speed to get into that quarterback. They're trying to get Holloway out to block him, but they can't do it. Watch him. Dent is just too fast. He comes in from the backside to polish off Grogan.
Fourth sack for the Bear defense. They had six. Oops. Looked as if the Patriots pulled off the line of scrimmage. McMichael started but didn't make contact. The onus is on the offensive line.
Grogan say, look, you guys are giving us enough problems when you come after we snap the ball. Come on, let us get the ball snapped anyway.
Ball start, number 61.
Against New England. Richard Dent from high school football in Atlanta, Georgia.
Oof.
Look at the speed of this man, 6'5 and 263 pounds. Does he close?
Almost runs like a linebacker, a defensive back. Got to be frustrating for Grogan. And we mentioned that severe leg injury and the fact that he has just taken a few snaps, but that didn't frighten Barry so much. He said the last time we put him in, hadn't taken any snaps with the offense. He came in instantly, threw for over 300 yards and led us to six victories in a row. So they have confidence in him. He's hit a pass here in the first play of the second half, but now he's facing long yardage situation. The Bears defense favorite kind of yardage.
Second and 20. Here they come. A jailbreak. Wilson and Hampton this time. If it were a fight, they'd have to stop it. The Bears second only to the Giants in most sacks for the year. New England in the top half of the NFL.
Watch the number of bodies in Bear uniforms that are coming in, three of them clean, and Grogan had just barely had time to set up back there. Wilson had stunted to the inside, Hampton from the outside. Boy, they're putting a squeeze on, and when you're ahead like this, you just go after the quarterback. That's the name of the game.
Third and 33. And the fade works to Starring, who's wrestled out of bounds at the 34-yard line. He got 24 of it, but that'll leave them short of the first down. That's the longest play of the game for New England. Dave Dorison made the hit. Rich Camarillo comes in to punt for the Patriots. So there's how Grogan buys time. He has to lob the ball, rainbow it up there, and hope that eventually it'll need a receiver fading downfield. Ortego stands at his 23. Bad kick. Slides it off the side of the foot. It'll take a New England bounce, however. And on that carpet, that'll delight Camarillo and the Patriots. It was just bad enough to get a tremendous roll, and Chicago will start inside the five on a 62-yard Camarillo punt. Camarillo has set a Super Bowl record 62-yard punt, breaking Gerald Wilson of the Chiefs' 61-yarder. He'll tell his kids, a beautiful spiral all the way on the fly. McMahon with good play action going for the bomb from his own end zone to Gault. They won't catch him except by the shirt tail. Marion saved the touchdown. So the Bears unloading with that great defense. They're showing all the weaponry, and McMahon from his own end zone hits Gault for 59 yards.
Well, how many times can you see a quarterback freeze a defense with a fake? That's what McMahon was able to do, and then Gault just uses his speed. It's all Marion can muster to get a handful of jersey, but it was enough to pull Willie Gault down. And this Bear defense has done what really very few teams have been able to do during the year against the Patriot defense. Repeatedly strike for the big game.
And Gault
who has had his critics in Chicago. He's had some drops during the course of the year. He's been perfect at 60 yards on that one. He has 130 yards for the game. Emory Moorhead gets in the act, and the tight end has another first down at the 22-yard line. Let's go back to the fake by McMahon and Bob Greasy.
Here's Gault over here, Dick. He's just going to release inside and go across. The play-action fake is going to hold the defensive man. Marion in the middle of the field is not faked out at all, but the two corners, the corner and the strong safety to the right of your screen right there, were both beaten, and that's why the play worked.
When you consider you're working against a man who runs about a 9-200, that was a pretty good play by Marion just to get the shirt tape.
That makes you want to line up awfully deep in that safety position, I'll tell you that.
Thanks to Gault, McMahon's yardage up to 222. Walter Payton to the 20-yard line. Yeah, they throw those away just a couple of yards.
The danger now for the Patriot defense is that they're getting desperate. They're trying to make the big play, and very often when you're trying to make the big play, you lose the integrity of the defense. There are going to be some holes in there. That's the time that you see Walter Payton pop a long one. There's Rod Rust, and oh, what a horrible day for him. His defense has been so consistent. In fact, that's been the mark of his defense.
But they've been on the field the whole day.
Yes, they have. Yes, they have.
Payton. Drawing a crowd, picks up five more. Adams and Tippett and Veris and Nelson all in on the stop.
Steve Nelson, the inside man, a linebacker, does for this defense what Singletary does for the Chicago defense. He calls all the signals, calls the adjustments. Heading out to the Pro Bowl, has had another fine year and is playing hurt. You see the tape on that arm. He's got that shoulder strapped down from an injury he suffered in Miami. You'd have to knock him out and drag him off the field, even in a losing game like this.
New England trying to at least force a Butler field goal. Suhey. He's trying to be close. And that last effort, it appears they've marked it inside the 12, which would be a first down. It is. Steve Fuller, the backup quarterback, a Rhodes Scholar candidate when he was at Clemson. The Bears have three of those. Brian Bashnagel on the injured list. Another, Stephon Humphreys at Michigan, a great student, was a Rhodes candidate. First down at the 12. Let's listen. Suhey inside the 10. Julius Adams dragging him down. Adams, who played his college ball at Texas Southern, joined the Patriots in 1971.
This is not the way that Julius had planned this season. I don't know that he ever dreamed of being in this game except idly because of the way the Patriot seasons of the past had gone, and now to get here and to have this dream apparently shattered. A little frustrating for that man.
23-3, the Bears lead it and are growling for more. Incomplete, intended for Dennis McKinnon. Ronnie LaPette on the coverage. Well, it goes a long time for those in Chicago, 1963, and Mike Ditka was on that George Halas coach team that beat the New York Giants in the cold at Wrigley Field, 14-10. With all those great teams and the fantastic fans that have supported them in all sports, they come ever so close, but it's been nothing but frustration for 22 years for the fans of Chicagoland. Ditka is ever closer to changing that, and will there be a celebration? Wide open. Can Margerum stop just short of a touchdown by Roland James? But that is a Another bare first down, first and goal inside the one.
McMahon is arguing that Margerum had that ball over the goal line.
Guess who's coming in?
Let's see where he is when he catches that football. He's well outside. He'll turn back. Well, hard to see. Roland James doing a good job of stripping him. Here's a better angle of it.
It appeared that the ball did not cross the plane of James. Twisting him down. Perry is in the refrigerator. He's the lone setback now, and it's all disguised. McMahon rolls in a somersault six, and the Bears lead 29-3.
Well, just like those hot players in Las Vegas, the Bears keep rolling those sevens all day long, and McMahon and his offensive linemen have been celebrating with those headbutts. There may be a couple of headaches in that group tonight.
I hope that doesn't catch on around the country, especially in the broadcast booth.
Well, he marches to his own drummer. Dicta says he's young. He'll grow out of some of that stuff.
Well, you don't want him to forget how to do some of those things, Dick.
Butler adds the extra point. That caps a 96-yard drive and 9 plays for the Bears. They've done it from short range. Now they've done it the full length of the field. On the touchdown by McMahon, apparently a penalty marked off now at the 50-yard line. Here's McMahon. He scored. Roland James will reach in. McMahon wants to spike it. James just casually knocks the ball out of his hands. McMahon, in turn, throws it to James. And after that, a little push and shove, and the penalty went against New England. 15 yards, and the Bears will kick off from the 50. And Starring will sit on that one, and the Patriots will play it from the 20-yard line.
Dick, you get an idea of McMahon's spiciness and toughness. They were telling me that in the Giant game that Lawrence Taylor came by McMahon chasing in pursuit on a play, and McMahon threw on the back of his legs in the legal clip zone and knocked him down. Now, how many quarterbacks are going to go after a linebacker like that on the field? He thinks he's Ditka says it. He thinks he's the best running back we got on the team, thinks he's the best quarterback, and also thinks he's one of the better blockers.
They might put him next to Perry in the middle of the line. He does have a lineman's mentality.
Well, his teammates love him for that, too. He is really a favorite with them.
No, I say that in a positive way. It sounds like a knock on him, but he's a tough guy. And
it's not a knock on me.
I got to go home with you. James can't catch the ball. It'll be second and 10. And the Chicago Bears chief executive officer and president, who has won some awards as the executive of the year in the NFL, and deservedly so, and how granddad George Halas must be proud of Michael McCaskey, the 43-year-old. Well, there he is, 43-year-old grandson of Papa Bear, there without the jacket on. What a year.
He's got to be terribly thrilled. Just terribly thrilled. For all of the people in Chicago.
Second and 10 for Grogan. Down 30-3. James gets two. Duerson makes the tackle. You wonder at this point, Merlin, 30-3, if Mike Ditka will call off some of that 46 defense and just play it a little straighter and not really punish the Patriots, or is that in this game?
Well, I got to remind you that Buddy Ryan calls the defenses. In fact, there's been a little bit of friction between he and Ditka because that's the option play. Grogan coming down on the option. They're pulling out all the stops. He just comes down and flipped that ball out to James, but even then, can't do it. Got an interesting story I'll tell you about him in just a second, Dick.
Give James three on that carry. Here they come. And intercepted for a touchdown, the rookie Reggie Phillips. Reggie Phillips from SMU, a second-round draft pick this year, playing because of the injury to Leslie Frazier, and he will tuck away a Super Bowl thrill.
He's still got his hands on that football.
with its special commemorative Super Bowl 20 on it. That'll sit proudly. That ball, not badly thrown, bounced in the air. That's just like serving it up.
28 yards unofficially on the return by Phillips, who did not have an interception during the course of the year. Kevin Butler adds the extra point. No doubt about this one. The Bears' long drought for Chicago will end here in New Orleans.
Ramsey, a tight end, and that ball was thrown behind him. He had to turn back, just got enough to bat it up.
Down to Starring comes the kickoff. And he's bumped out of bounds at the 30-yard line. Dennis Gentry in on the tackle.
Dick, I started to tell a story about Buddy Ryan. This is not the first time that Buddy Ryan has lined up opposite of Coach Berry on the other side of the field. You mentioned it, that Raymond Berry's father is coaching down in Texas, and Ryan also coached down there. Raymond's father's at Paris. He coached at Gainesville in that 6 AAA league, and he said we always called him Coach Berry because he was a little older than we were.
You know, Buddy Ryan came to the Bears with Neil Armstrong, and when Armstrong was fired as the head coach, Gary Fensick wrote a letter to George Halas and said, we want Buddy Ryan to stay. He was going to be swept out with Armstrong. Long to Morgan, and broken up by Mike Richardson at the last moment.
Just as a tag to that story, Mike Ditka was not terribly happy that he couldn't choose all of his own staff. But let's look at Morgan on that play, working man-to-man on Richardson. With time for Grogan, he gets that ball deep. But Richardson again closes as that ball slightly underthrown. He gets his hands on it and knocks it away.
Well, we start to deal in those kinds of statistics, and we're only 6 minutes left in the third quarter. Could be the biggest rout in history. Has all the earmarks, doesn't it? Complete, and then a fumble, and the Bears have it again. Wilbur Marshall at the 40. Marshall laterals to Wilson. Hello. And finally Wilson down at the 38. And they're playing playground with the Patriots now. Cedric Jones belted after making that catch, and the Bears have another turnover.
Grogan did his part, got the ball downfield, had enough yardage for the first down, but Cedric Jones is just going to take a real hit right there. Bam! Fensick, number 45, looked like he'd been fired out of a cannon. That ball took one hop, and Marshall, who has great speed for a linebacker, that looks like a little rugby going on there, Dick.
Oh, my. Oh, the Bears have it at the 38-yard line. Leading 37-3 with 5:43 left in the third. Walter Payton tackled by Steve Nelson. And now, as long as the Bears seem to be on a touchdown tirade, I think the fans, even the Patriot fans who might be succumbing to all of this, would want Payton to have a touchdown. If there's going to be another Bear to score, I think everyone's rooting for this man.
Well, he's mounting some yardage, obviously, and you have to know that he is the number one priority of that Patriot defense.
They're chanting Walter, Walter. Stutter and that limp leg, and then the charge, driving inside the 25 for a first down, a 6-yard carry. That helmet looked worn. He's been wearing the same one since his rookie year in 75.
A few grooves and scratches on that helmet. There's the little stutter step you talked about, and Payton has his own way of striding in the open field, almost his signature with that ball.
Yeah, well documented. He was a winner of the Soul Train dance contest out of high school, and he's used that fancy footwork well in the NFL. This time, Drop for a loss as Roland James and Steve Nelson make the hit.
You could hear Nelson popping in on that play from up here. Dick, one of the things that Mike Ditka had to do when he went to Chicago was to straighten out a real feud between the offense and the defense there. The defense had become so dominant that they were actually intimidating their own offense. Ditka could remember that because back in, even in 63, when the Bears won the championship, that was a team where the defense dominated again. The Bears won that championship averaging only about 10 points a game on offense. And the offense would come off the field after making a mistake. The defense would push them around and shove them. So Ditka had some experience there.
That is an incomplete pass. Ball whistled in. Well, that was a, let's remember, it's a Fortunato and a Morris and Obradovich and
Bill George, the middle linebacker, Doug Atkins. Of the all-time greats. And you know, we saw the score earlier for that championship game, which was what, 14-10.
Right.
And in that game, the two scores came off interception returns that set up field position on the 14-yard line and the 7-yard line. They ended up taking it in for scores to get the two touchdowns.
Well, there's one man watching today that can identify with Eason and Grogan. That's Y.A. Tittle. Remember how they battered him that day in 63. Third down and long. Wide open. Touchdown, Dennis Gentry. Nope. He says he stepped out of bounds at the 1-yard line. First and goal at the one. Gentry so close to his touchdown.
And I wonder who's going to get the call on this 1-yard line.
Well, Walter Payton doesn't have one. They're sending in Perry. Or are they?
Yep, they are. Here's McMahon again using his mobility to get open. Nobody home.
Oh, I don't think that he was out of bounds when he caught the ball, wasn't he?
Maybe we can look at the end of that play.
Not that they need any extra help, but it looked as if he did. He didn't even have 1 foot down, much less two. From that angle, maybe we can get another view. First of all, the reality of first and goal. 380. Perry. That one registered 3.8. Another Super Bowl record, the first refrigerator to score.
And the largest running back ever to score a touchdown.
And Walter Payton, I guess they figure they got a whole quarter to go.
And they're going to run out of footballs the way they're going.
Well, they had 36 to start. Butler to add the extra point. Well, there is some drama left. Who will score next? Yeah. 43-3. Super Bowl shuffle is on the other sidelines.
Occasionally you'll see a Patriot player lift his eyes and look at the scoreboard.
And the clock.
And the clock. And I'm sure they can't believe what they see there.
Stephen Starring has been as busy as anyone. And ooh, does he get hit there? Well, I thought the Dennis Gentry catch was not in bounds, and the Patriots aren't the only team that's had a rough day. The officials have had some problems too.
Right here, touches the ball, and the first foot,
neither foot was in,
is on the line. The second one is on the out of bounds. So,
well, thank goodness that isn't in a 3-3 game that play occurs. That'll open up that can again about having television as a element for the officials.
Well, and that's a camera that aims right down the sideline, so the angle won't lie.
Starring, and Richardson bumps him out of bounds after a gain of 18. Make that 15. Tony Eason, starter, went 0 for 6, sacked 3 times, fumbled the ball, and gave way to Steve Grogan.
Came down with the flu late in the week, running a temperature, and well, I tell you, I think it was sick to his stomach before he left the field today. I'm not so sure it was the flu that was still after him. Might have been the way the Bears were after him.
Look at that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 men on the line of scrimmage. Grogan to Morgan. Is he inbounds? Yes. Complete at the 47 of the Bears. And this is the first time on their own. McMahon having that left hand wrapped in ice. First time that the Patriots have driven into Bear territory on their own. Their score, the field goal, came after they recovered a Payton fumble inside the Chicago 20 early in the game.
As I remember, they only made one excursion into Patriot territory.
Pluto, he's into outer space. Well, that only figures. Starring, almost intercepted by Mike Richardson. A flag is down. Dave Durison was the defensive back charging through on Grogan, but picked up neatly by the New England line. Offside against the Bears. There's a man who has paid his dues, veteran Steve Nelson, 12 years out of North Dakota State.
I'll tell you, nobody worked harder today. Something that people don't understand, I think, who haven't been a part of a team. On a day when you're losing, you often play so much harder and burn so much energy, you come out of here almost crawling, and yet nothing has gone right. Frustration. Oh, almost an inner rage along that sideline, but that and disbelief.
Robert Weathers hit by Durison. Now here's Weathers at 222 and Durison 20 pounds lighter. And was that a picture book tackle?
What a bright man, too. There's a great story out of the Ram playoff game. They said that as the Bears had gone into that nine-man front, that Dieter Brock had lined up and Dickerson walked up to Brock and said, "You are going to audible, aren't you?"
Notre Damer, Durison. Second and two. Dent was offside. They'll go through the play. Derek Ramsey to the 28. Flags down. Most of that yardage coming here in the third quarter. Bad leg and all. Grogan scrambling to the 26-yard line. A gain of about 3. That Bear defense will be well represented in the Pro Bowl. Dent and Hampton, the two ends, Singletary and Wilson, two linebackers, and Durison made it at a safety. And you wonder what Todd Bell, who was a Pro Bowler last year, playing Durison's spot. He held out all year long. He lost this opportunity to be on a Super Bowl team.
Buddy Ryan said very simply he was the most important man in that defensive unit because he had to play linebacker, safety, had to handle so many responsibilities, and yet they have operated beautifully without him.
Richardson again getting a hand on a pass intended for Stanley Morgan. Going back to Al Harrison and Todd Bell, the two Bears, two starters, two outstanding players who decided to sit out the year. There's a message there that really even the great ones are replaceable.
Well, and watch the frustration of a quarterback.
I think he felt he was hit late on that.
I think he did. I think he did, and I'm not so sure he wasn't right.
He didn't see the ball. Well, Miss Morgan, that's not why he was reacting. And the Bears have called a timeout. We're in the final minute of the third quarter, 44-3. We'll give you a word on the injury to McMahon in a moment. There's Weathers. Twisted down by Wilbur Marshall, who was a number one pick, and he's hurt out of the University of Florida. And speaking of injuries, McMahon's injury is serious enough that he won't play the rest of the day, that injured wrist, and undoubtedly we'll see the man who capably filled in for him, Steve Fuller, in several games during the course of the season.
Earlier in the year, McMahon, who is quite superstitious, was a little bit frightened because he'd been hurt in the ninth game last year, wearing number 9, hurt in the ninth game against the Raiders last year, hurt in the ninth game this year. When the doctors checked on him, they looked at that shoulder, the first answer, the first diagnosis was an operation for McMahon. They got a second opinion, happily, and they said a couple of weeks, rest would do it, which was true.
First down from the 18.
That ball is down when Grogan touched it down at the 30-yard line, and Dan Hampton gets the sack this time. Hampton, who didn't play football till he was a junior in high school. He played the drums, guitar, saxophone, piano, and now plays on quarterback.
Oh, does he ever. And I've got to believe that with this overwhelming performance on defense, not just here today, but throughout this year, we'll have more mini bear defenses popping up very soon.
And we'll be back after these messages from your local station. 44-3, we open the fourth quarter. Patriots, their deepest drive, appear to be an offside Bears, and Mosi Tatupu, that's the first time he's been in the backfield, unable to handle a pass. Two penalties against the Bears, and that was why the confusion, both illegal use of the hands and offside, both 5-yard penalties, but the penalty, one penalty carries a first down, so the Patriots take that one. In 1963, it was a great year for the Bears. The Patriots, the only other time they went to a championship game was in the American Football League championship. Julius Adams was not in that one. He came a little bit later, and that also was a disastrous result out at Balboa Stadium in San Diego, where the Chargers beat then the Boston Patriots 51-10. Morgan, and Stanley Morgan has first and goal at the 8.
The defensive line coach for the Patriots, Eddie Kayat, was on that team that lost disastrously, and he said, he actually was on the team that was going to try and have a chance at the first Super Bowl, which was later. That's 19 years ago, and he said that Mr. Sullivan had bought them sport coats. Let's watch the refrigerator getting iced down on this one. Look out. Ooh.
You think that helmet isn't a weapon? Boom. Grogan throws it away. Tatupu had two men there, Dorison and Richardson.
Just quickly to finish that story, 19 years ago, Eddie Kayat was playing for Mr. Sullivan, playing for the Patriots. They were hoping to be in the first Super Bowl, and he bought them sport coats. Three-button sport coats to wear to the game, to the Super Bowl. They never got a chance to wear them, and Eddie's wife kept trying to throw it out over the years. He wore it on the way down here for this game. Maybe now he'll let her throw it out.
That's kind of a bittersweet story. Morgan, and he's down for a loss. In case you're wondering, only one team has not scored a touchdown in Super Bowl history. The Miami Dolphins. You remember that one? Well, Bob Greasy was involved, and we'll get his reaction in a moment. We'll get that microphone open. There's Steve Fuller getting ready to replace Jim McMahon. Bob, were you healthy that year?
I'm sitting here cringing during this whole ball game, thinking back to when Dallas beat us, whatever it was, 24-3 or something.
Right,
but I remember very well not scoring a touchdown.
Well, here's Grogan trying to get the Patriots off the hook on third and goal. Misses Stanley Morgan. Fourth and goal. That was Super Bowl VI, and the Cowboys prevailed 24-3. But Greasy and the Dolphins would make amends. They won the next 2 years.
You should see Bob orchestrating that. You look, like John Williams in the Boston Pops.
That's the undefeated season.
And then they handed it to the Vikings. Well, the Patriots obviously aren't going to go for a field goal here. And the Bear fans don't want their team to give up a touchdown. But they get it. Irving Fryer. First time they've thrown to him today, and Fryer clutches the Patriots' only touchdown.
Fryer, as we said, wanted so desperately to make the big play, to do something, felt he'd let his team down. Well, there's a little face saving in putting a touchdown on the board, even though the score is 44-9.
Well,
Bears have only had to kick one, so Fryer hasn't had any chance to return any, and that was that long kick by Buford that Fryer unable to return. Franklin adds the extra point. 13 minutes and 14 seconds left, and the Bears lead by 34. Franklin about to kick off, 44-10. The Bears have already established a Super Bowl scoring record, 44 points. The last two Super Bowls, San Francisco and the Raiders, scored 38, and we have almost a full quarter to go. Willie Gault. And he's to the 24-yard line. Good hit by number 52, Johnny Rembert. Dallas Cowboys. That's a small world, this world of football. The team picture in 1969, it featured the two coaches in the game today. Raymond Berry was an assistant coach for Tom Landry, and the veteran tight end was Mike Ditka.
We asked him how Ditka was as a player, and he said when Ditka got there, Ditka's body had really been hammered, and he was not able to run, but he was still doing some great things. He came back the next year after working out twice a day through all of the spring and summer, and actually ran a 4.7 in the training camp.
Steve Fuller has taken over at quarterback, and he knows who to give the ball to. Walter Payton. Roland James makes the stop after a 7-yard gain. And again, for those of you that may be joining us in progress, with the score 44-10, William the Refrigerator Perry has a touchdown. The quarterback McMahon, a couple of sneaks for touchdown. But Walter Payton does not have a touchdown. And so much focus on Payton, who labored through years where, well, this is the first year he's run behind a man judged in the Pro Bowl, a lineman. He's picked up all those record-setting yards behind men judged by their peers as not being Pro Bowl players. Nothing there.
Dick, we have talked about the domination by the Bears defensive line. How about this Bears offensive line? Covert and Bortz and Hilgenberg and Thayer and Van Horn. They have been almost as awesome in the way they have been able to control the Patriots defense and to move that ball down the field, clearing broad holes and alleys for their running backs.
You know, this is a team that's not exactly gray in the mustache either. They are the youngest team in the NFC. They average only 25.1 years of age, the Bears. Now Ditka has really built something special here. Payton out of bounds at the 33. That'll be short of the first down by a couple of yards.
It's been said of the Bears that they are a traditional team featuring the running attack, featuring their defense, but they also do something that you have to know about. Ditka unhappy even there with a mistake as he talks to his quarterback. They've controlled the line of scrimmage, the best running game in football in the last 3 years, and of course the best defense against the run this year, the number one defense this year too.
Maury Buford, a former San Diego Charger, acquired in the summer this year by the Bears. Irving Fryer looking for his first chance to return. This is Buford's second kick of the game. That statistic revealing the dominance of the Bears. It's another good one. Fryer at the 30. Ooh, tripped up at the 38, and he had a lot of blockers out in front. Jim Bowman made the play that might have saved a touchdown. Or actually made the block. Derek Ramsey, another fumble, and the Bears have it at the 43-yard line. Or are they going to rule that an incomplete pass?
No, it's a Bear fumble.
Mike Singletary, when you hear the popping, you know he's right around it. But it was Sean Gale who delivered the blow, and Singletary covered the ball.
Sean Gale doesn't get many chances except in the long yardage. He takes advantage of it here as you look from high above. Good pass by Grogan to his tight end across the middle. But watch the hit by Sean Gale right here. Head on the football. Nowhere to go. Singletary, so alert, picks it up.
Here's Gale again as Ramsey comes out, gets the ball, and gets Gale. Boy, we've seen it from every man on the team. They just don't hit. They don't just grab you. They really bury a shoulder and a helmet into you. Steve Fuller, the Margerum, incomplete, broken up by LePet. Well, this game is being televised not only into millions of homes in the United States, but around the world, carried in England Live and France and Italy. First time ever, People's Republic of China. The QE2, 100 miles off the coast of Peru, through satellite, is watching today. And we wish you all well from New Orleans. And I know there's someone special watching in England, or Daddy.
Well, I'm going to get a critique from my daughter Kelly, who's over there at Cambridge watching this live, staying up late.
A long game for those fellas. Walter Payton, little misdirection. And down at the 41-yard line. LePet. Ronnie LePet has played a solid game at that corner against pass and run.
Hurt a couple of times early, but has come back to make some big hits and make some good plays.
He, like Payton, the man he just tackled, when they're not playing football, like to work behind the drums. They can both handle the skins. Miami of Florida. Margerum, Ortego. Two backup receivers are in. Dennis Gentry is in, and Gault in. So they go with four wide. Third and eight. Wide open is Payton, but the pass just out of his reach. Payton, along with all of his many marks, is the Bears' all-time receiver. 422. Ditka had 427, but some of those came when he was with the Cowboys.
The Bears have put together an offense that has poked holes in the defense of the Patriots all day long. That ball thrown just a little bit further, and Payton is off and running.
Could you walk on your hands? Could you stand on your hands? They say he can go 50 yards on his hands, Walter Payton. That's how strong he is.
I might have broken my neck if I'd have tried that.
At least bruise your nose. Buford to punt to Fryer. Oh, beautifully kicked by Buford and downed at the 4-yard line. Patriots start from the 4-yard line. And Grogan from his end zone unloads to Fryer. Just misses connections. And Fryer, frustrated, will return to the huddle in the end zone. The GSH is, most all of you know, but some of you perhaps watching the Bears for the first time, of course, is in tribute to George S. Halas, who told so many marvelous stories. I remember sitting in his office one day and regaling me for a couple of hours as we did a feature on him, and told us about when he went to see Calvin Coolidge, the president of the United States, in Washington, D.C. And Mr. Coolidge, not a football fan, when told that George Halas and the Chicago Bears were there, thought he was going to see a circus act. He was looking for the for the animals, not the football team. Morgan, and he's out to the 18-19 yard line. That'll be a first down. Ron Rivera made the tackle. So the Bears now, you see Cliff Thrift in there, Ron Rivera, as Mike Ditka is going to give everyone a chance to play.
Important that each of those players be able to say, not only was I a part of that Bear team, but I played. I think you'll see Raymond Berry doing the same thing toward the end of this game, giving each of his players a chance to at least get out on the field.
Wholesale changes. There's Michael McCaskey, the 43-year-old grandson of Halas, now the president of the club. Tony Collins, and he's out to another first down at the 30-yard line. Mike Hartenstein, the veteran from Penn State, the oldest Bear, made the tackle, and congratulations already being sent and accepted on that Bear sideline. Billy Gault said, well, Mr. President, how about a bonus then? How about a raise next year? Gault had a big game, and when they needed long yardage, he was there.
I wonder if maybe Richard Dent won't stop him and say, look, I didn't hold out. In fact, I was here all day long today. Maybe we ought to sit down and talk about my contract.
Fryer out of bounds at the 45-yard line with another first down, a 16-yard play. Stops the clock. 8 minutes and 8 seconds left in this Super Bowl 20. dominated by the Bears. The Patriots forced a fumble early from Walter Payton, got 3 points out of it, but they struggled after that, and the Bears dominating, in fact, New England with only one first down the entire first half today.
That's Dawson, Lynn Dawson on the sideline with that knee propped up. Certainly one of the blows that these Patriots took early took them out of some of their game plan offensively.
Tight end was injured on the first scrimmage play. Another intercept on his way. Tim Morrissey to the 5 yard line. Jim Morrissey, the rookie from Michigan State. Tony Collins saved the touchdown. Morrissey, a ninth round draft pick. 48 yards on the return.
Looking right down from the gondola high above, you see Grogan, and that ball zipping over the head of the intended receiver. And then it's another Bear celebration.
But look at Collins, how he hustled to get to him. He went after him with pride, did he not?
He certainly did.
And so we see number 72. Will Walter Payton get his chance?
I wonder if this, you know, that Patriot defense has got to feel like they've been out there all day, because they have. They have literally been on the field almost the entire day.
So it's first and goal with just under 8 minutes left, 44-10. The Bears have invited the Patriots into their den, and the Bears were hardly in hibernation, but they'll sleep well after this one. Payton. Everyone in red knew he was going to get the ball. He pays for it, a couple of yard gain.
Those folks out there aren't lying down on the ground. Did you hear the popping on that play? Ooh.
Payton said he wishes he could play defense. He said, I just love to hit. And he is the kind of back that just doesn't come in there side saddling his way. He comes right at you. Perry goes out. John Hanna, the great all-pro guard of the Patriots.
Gotta wonder at what must be going through his mind right at this moment.
His brother Charlie has a Super Bowl championship ring with the Raiders 2 years ago.
Steve Moore.
Derek Ramsey. Second and goal from the four. And a flag goes down. Steve Nelson, certainly king on Payton in this situation.
Well, you have to wonder, Dick. The Bears talked about the fact that that loss, that very one-sided game to the 49ers, really set their emotional key for this season and pointed them at this Super Bowl. They flew through the season and they arrived here to carry home their victory. Perhaps this game may do the same thing for the New England Patriots, who have proved to be such a wonderful and surprising team in the AFC, and yet have been destroyed
illegal
here
block.
Today.
Number 87 on the offense, still second down.
Emory Moorhead, the tight end, with a block, a 10-yard penalty out to the 14. Well, the Bears, hey, you know, the perfect season of the Miami Dolphins was not equaled only because the Dolphins were able to beat the Bears on that Monday night. They had to block a kick and do some other very special things, and it was a well-constructed offense by Shula as Miami beat them 38-24 to deny them the perfect year. Oh, he was beyond the line of scrimmage. Fuller had already crossed the line of scrimmage when he threw the ball. That's a penalty. Illegal forward pass.
And Brett Cashin agrees.
Steve Grogan was actually joking earlier this week. He was going to try to put himself in on special teams because he didn't think he'd get a chance to play at quarterback today. And
the slow start by Eason, the way they battered him around, and perhaps Eason's flu had something to do with it. Grogan thrown into the fire.
Illegal forward pass beyond the line of scrimmage. Number four on the offense, 5 yards from where it was thrown, plus loss of a down. The third down.
So you get a double dose on that penalty, 5 yards plus losing a down. And so now it becomes third and goal from the 18. Ditka with a deep set eyes and they're close together in that furrowed brow and the way he does his hair. He even has a bear look, does he not? Calvin Thomas, 245 pounds, and it takes a lot to bring him down at the 12. We talked, you did, Merlin, about how Payton hustles every play, even when he doesn't have the ball.
I think it's like basketball. A lot of times it's what a man does away from the ball that tells you the most about his character. There's Payton downfield to throw a great block on Steve Nelson. I'll tell you, that hurt. This is a tragic and sad chapter of New England history, to get so close to that championship and to have things crumble around you. Theirs is still an exciting story in 1985.
Indeed. Payton to the four. And another many fans, Bear fans, who are not going to leave the Superdome hoping they'll see Payton score a touchdown. Even though it's 44-10, and there's no question there'll be a mighty roar if Payton should go in, but unable to make it there. Stopped at the four. That was a fourth and goal after the penalties. They lost it down, of course, with that illegal forward pass. So Payton will now watch the clock. 5:48 left. Timeout. Bears 44, Patriots 10. No question, New England's defense keyed on Walter Payton, and they were successful in that regard. Nothing over 10 yards. But in the meantime, McMahon had some big plays passing, and Matt Suhey early on was a force. Good teams, you can take one player away, but the rest of the guys fill in quickly. Grogan looking for starring, and good coverage by Reggie Phillips.
Bob Greasy, this has to be the toughest part of a game for a quarterback. Everyone in the park, including us, know that Grogan's going to throw that ball deep, and everybody is dropping back. They're not giving him any room. It's got to be tough.
It's tough, and I'm sure that Steve Grogan, as much as he wanted to play in a Super Bowl, Merlin, would have given that up for a Patriot victory and then let Tony Eason take the whole game.
44-10, the Bears. 46-10, the Bears. He was down, whistled at safety, Chicago. Henry Waxter from Nebraska. And I know you Bear fans even call him Henry Wechter up there, but he told Merlin, did he not, that, hey, they're mispronouncing my name.
We walked in and talked to him Champaign, Illinois, and said, Henry, how do you pronounce your last name? Because I didn't know. He said, it's Waxter, just like beeswax. And so, Henry Waxter, congratulations. You've just scored 2 points in the Super Bowl.
Grogan tried to flip it ahead, but was already down on one knee. So, some unlikely names in the scoring column for the Bears today. Phillips and Waxter. Morrissey almost had one.
Well, they had 9 Bears on defense score during the regular season. Now add Henry Waxter's name to that list. And of course, that doesn't count the refrigerator, William Perry, scoring on offense.
Bell and Harris. Kind of think they'd like to come back. Willie Gault says, I'll just go over here. I'll go into the infield.
Dick, one of the things that concerned me as the Bears played their way through the early part of the year, they played such emotional football that I thought they might burn out. And I said, boy, how do you maintain this pace? Well, I got to give Mike Ditka and his whole staff credit. They were able to keep that energy level up and help this team sustain their play. They were the best team that we saw during the year in the NFL. They played the best football in the NFL all year, and here they are saving perhaps their best for this Super Bowl game.
Well, Michael Keller Ditka has done a superb job. Fuller will lead it. Ben Thomas, rookie from Auburn, has a sack and a 13-yard loss. 280-pounder. Was a second-round choice by the Patriots in New England, a team that has considerable youth. And it's a team that always thought they might be good, and about the middle of the year they said, hey, maybe we are good, and in the playoffs proved that they are good and can use this as a platform for next year as well. But the sad part of it is they're the last loser of the year. Everyone else is forgotten. They're the ones that we'll have to remember. Fuller trying to hit Tim Reitman, the tight end. The combination of sacks, 7 by the Bears and 3 by the Patriots, is a Super Bowl record, just to clean up that little piece of business.
If you lose a game during the regular season, and I think Bob would agree, you come back and you look at that film and you take what you can pull out of it and you say, hey, next weekend, 7 days from now, we can change all of that. We can be heroes one weekend, we can be bums the next, we can be heroes the next weekend. But when you lose in the Super Bowl, you've got a whole off season to think about this day.
Payton, the shot you just saw was also flashed up on the television screens here at the Superdome, and that provoked the applause you heard in the background. But apparently his afternoon is through. Fuller dodges Tippett and now throws for Gentry, but he went out of bounds and could not get back in bounds, although bumped out of bounds by the Patriot defense.
Take a question for Bob Greasy again, and it goes back to those three Super Bowls that back-to-back that you participated in. Losing the first one, losing it badly, did that help to focus the energy of the team? Did Shula use that as a stepping point, if you will, or a starting point for the next year?
No question about it, Merlin. And I can remember his talk in the locker room after the game, as building towards next year, and the sad feeling in that locker room having come this far and knowing that you got to go back and do all the hard work just to get back to where you were before that Super Bowl game. We came back and went 17-0. We were really very motivated.
Buford under pressure. Just does get it away to Fryer at the New England 39. Flag down as Fryer out of bounds at the 49. 44-yard punt, 10-yard return. Flanker screen to Morgan. No gain. We said to Perry before, I was the MC, it was a black tie affair there in Houston, and said to him, now I'm going to start kidding you about your nickname. I'd never met him before. I'll say, up in your head, and I'll say, now that's where you have all your ice cream, and you got some ice cubes up there. And then I went to his chest. That's, you know, there's some milk and a couple of six packs in there. And I got done. When I got to 3 pounds of bacon, he picked me up by the belt buckle and lifted me right off the ground and held me there. And with that big, wonderful grin of his, you could see how endearing he is. And for him to do what he's done on offense has really captured the country. Grogan under pressure has to throw quickly, and it was Waxter in on top of him along with Tyrone Keyes. Stephen Starring at the other end. Intended for Fryer. The toughest job in all of sports casting is the other locker room.
And I think it will be particularly difficult today.
The players of the Bears, when you consider, here's a guy that Buddy Ryan said that was a bad draft choice. He didn't like him when they picked him number one. But he's such a good guy that even with all the publicity, the veteran Bears aren't envious. They love him. South Carolina, you bet. Clemson.
I think Buddy used that publicity to motivate this young man to lose some weight more than anything else. He's become a much better football player because of it.
Camarillo roots one to Dave Dorsey, who'll let it bounce. And they can't stop it from going into the end zone, and it'll be a touchback of the 20, a 51-yard punt.
Duerson did a good job of faking that catch. That ball bounced away into the end zone.
Thomas Sanders, a rookie from Texas A&M in there, and the quarterback is Mike Tomczak of Ohio State.
One of the questions that Mike Ditka must be asking himself now, what do we do for an encore to this season? Of course, the obvious is the undefeated season. But one of the problems he may have to face is that Buddy Ryan has been rumored to be the next coach of the Philadelphia Eagles. In fact, it's been said that the job has been or will be offered to him shortly. And what happens to this great defense if Buddy Ryan leaves Chicago?
Oh, my. Matt Suhey getting a good hit from Johnny Rembert. Well, Billy Sullivan, the owner of the New England Patriots. We've seen his smile during the playoffs. But those are long memories now. Needless to say, the opposition.
We don't even need the scoreboard, do we?
.43 at the start and about .23 right now. He's about the only one who hasn't played on that Bear sideline.
Well, and appropriately so. I know that they're inside that tough exterior of Mike Ditka's. There's also some compassion. He's been on the losing side many times.
Suhey rumbling to a first down. Now Ditka said to us the other day, I want to justify George Halas's confidence in me. I want the old man to be proud of me. Final 2 minutes, 46-10, the Bears. It's the rookie Thomas Sanders from Texas A&M, a number 9 draft pick of the Bears, and Ben Thomas makes the stop for New England. Well, what do you think, Bob Greasy? Do you think that this is a team, the Bears, that are constructed like your Dolphins of the early 70s or the Steelers later in the 70s to dominate the game for a few years?
I think, like you said, Dick, they have a very young team, the youngest in the National Football League. But taking off what Merlin said, if they lose Buddy Ryan, I don't know what's going to happen to that defense. But certainly you got to like their chances.
I don't know that we've ever seen a defense with the kind of shutdown power that these people have. I don't think I've ever seen one.
I can't figure out what they're doing half the time. I've been watching the whole game.
Just glad you're up here. Huh?
Exactly.
Tomczak to Sanders. And the high-stepping rookie is into New England territory at the 49 with a minute to go.
Well, that's been one of the secrets of this Bear defense. With all of their sophistication, they just won't beat themselves. And you go and watch their practice, you get a sense of why that is. They spend a lot of time out on the field. They have one of their meetings out on the field in what they call a concentration drill. They walk through very carefully to make sure that they don't blow their assignments defensively.
Mike Singletary, a genius on the field and running that difficult defense. And this probably the last play of the game. Getting ready to carry Ditka doesn't want to go yet. He says, wait till I see that final second. Who's going to argue with Perry? He wins most of those. Walter Payton, Mike Ditka, hungry Chicago, finally champions on this January day in New Orleans. 46-10, the final.